Except for the air conditioning sound.
Yes.
Okay, so I'll just give you.
I'm gonna go confirm order with Pastor Thomas.
Oh, I did. What he wants to do is.
Okay, good. Good.
Apostles' Creed.
Apostles' Creed, then they'll be seated. And I believe he wants the piece then, before he presents the elements. I would have preferred them to be taking the elements or thinking, and then in prayer. But he said no, so confirm that.
Sandy, tell me that too.
Because he should look at the email, get the text he sent me, if he can't remember.
Linda, are you staying up here the whole service? What?
I don't know. I don't think so.
I was thinking I would just.
I'm not just playing one of the hymns.
Well, I was thinking I would just come up after he's done.
That's right, he just, I told him that, and he just invited you to sit at the front if you want.
The entire service?
He can go at that side door if you want.
Well, not the entire service, it's just.
Oh, I was like, what's going on? He said that.
No, yeah, for the entire service, until the communion, until you sing. You can sit down there.
Okay.
But let's just try it, so I'll give you a true.
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship at Eastminster. Well, hello. Good to see you, Jenny. It is so good to be together, and our Puerto Rico team is back next week. We're going to get to see a video and hear a little bit more about what happened in Puerto Rico. I do want to draw your attention just to the bulletin before we begin. As always, there's prayer requests. There are a list of the elders, a little bit of information about the service and the order of worship. And then also just some of the things that are going on. The most important, or that I want to direct your attention to, is this call to prayer. For the past couple of weeks, we've been asking everyone in the church to pray for our elders, making a number of decisions. The session is considering making some offers to fill a couple of positions, our organist and choir director, as well as our church administrator positions. They're close to this, I believe, and so please continue to be in prayer for that. Also, the church budget We budget here at Bethany starting September 1 all the way through the end of August. So we're coming up to the end of one budget year. And so we would ask that you would be in prayer for this coming budget year as a session seeks to discern the mind of Christ regarding what the budget is to be and all the expenses. And we're going to have all that figured out. And then also the last thing is we are continuing to ask the session to make a decision regarding worship in the fall. And a number of things, the number of services, how we're going to celebrate communion. Today is a communion Sunday, and we still have these little guys. And you better believe I'm rallying to get rid of these suckers. But I think what we might end up, where I imagine we may end up, is that we may have a hybrid system. And so we may have these available for those who would like to continue to use these. And then we may also have an additional way for people to come forward. But nothing is set in stone, and so we're just in prayer. So be in prayer for our elders as they make these important decisions, and we are just great. Also, I want to let you know that we're going to have a family movie night on Friday, August 19th, and so we're going to do that actually downstairs in the youth room, and we'll have dinner at 6 p.m., and we're going to watch Joseph, the Sight and Sound Theater. I've got the DVD, and so we're going to watch that. We've been preaching through the story of Joseph. We'll get to see a wonderful rendition of the story of Joseph as well. So I encourage you to consider putting that on your calendar. Again, that's Friday, August 19th. We look forward to having you for that. Well, we are grateful to be together to worship our Lord. And it is time to begin worship. And so let me invite you to stand for our call to worship today. Our call to worship is going to come from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. Hear the word of the Lord. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us, in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. We are here to worship the Lord, to bring glory and praise to his name, and so let's worship the Lord as we sing together, Open Up the Heavens.
To you, your glory like a fire. floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise.
Let's sing that again.
We sing, open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Show us, Lord.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. We sing, open up the heavens. We want to see. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Oh Lord, when I in awesome wonder, thou sit around.
Well, I want to direct your attention now to the bulletin for the prayer request portion. There is one, at least one change here. Alice Sell, she passed away. She was our longest running member here at Bethany Church, and she died last week, outliving her funeral service that we had planned for her back in May. And we do have now another time, a memorial service planned for August 27th, and that is going to happen at Lima Estates in their chapel there. And so you are all invited. That's a Saturday. I believe it's 11 a.m. I'll have to check on that time, but more information will be sent out to everyone here. But I just want you to be aware. Let's continue to lift up the Sell family in our prayers as we think of them in this time of their loss. But let's pray. Let's pray together. Let's turn to the Lord. Heavenly Father, a joy it is to come before you and be gathered with our family, our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, some of our family returning from being with a part of our church family in Puerto Rico. And Lord, we are grateful for the experiences that so many of our young people and adult leaders were able to have as they helped with a vacation Bible school down there in our sister EPC church. Lord, we're grateful that you go before us and that you are at work not only here but all around the world. What a joy it is to be together in worship today as we think of our brothers and sisters all around the world who are lifting up your name above all other names. For Lord, you are worthy. You are the great God, the one true God. The one who is our Redeemer, the one who adopts us and makes us part of your family. Lord, what a treasure we have in you. And Lord, we know that this is a gift to us. It's your grace that allows us to come and be a part of your family. We don't deserve to be a part of your family. And in fact, our actions often show that we desire not to be a part of your family at times. But Lord, you are a good God, a loving God, a gracious God who is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast covenant love. And so, Lord, we thank you for allowing us to become part of your covenant people, allowing us to walk hand in hand with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we want to lift up the prayers and the praises that are in our bulletin. We pray for Rich and William and Billy. We pray for Jim and Ted and Harry. We lift up to you Chrissy and Peg and Roxanne and Harriet and Jane. We pray for Barbara and Al, for Bernard and for the family of Alice Sell. We lift up Bill, Melissa. We pray for Johan. We lift up Eric and Andrew. Lord, you know all of the requests, you know the details, you know the information behind each of these requests, each of these praises. Lord, we celebrate with those who are praising your faithfulness, your goodness to them today. And Lord, we ask for comfort and peace and for your ministry to be a part of those who are in need. Lord, you know our needs even before we ask, and so it is a joy to lift up these prayer requests to you, knowing that you are a good God, and that you love to give good gifts to your children. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. Would you hear us now as we pray together the prayer Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. As we gather to worship the Lord this day, we're reminded that we come to worship in a variety of ways, with prayers, with singing, with a proclamation of God's word, and with the giving and receiving of an offering. And so we celebrate that God gives us this opportunity to worship him with our tithes and our offerings. I know we're still doing the offering box in the back when you walk in. You can also mail checks here to the church. We have a locking mailbox, and you can go online and you can give online. But no matter which way you give, this is an act of worship where we say thank you to the Lord And it's very appropriate to say thank you because everything we have is from Him. And He has entrusted the resources that He has provided us to us, and we are to be good stewards of those resources. And so we're thankful this day. And when you give to this church, you are helping to see ministry go forth, not only here, but all around the world. A part of the giving of this church went to support our short-term mission trip down in Puerto Rico, to help out with the Vacation Bible School, one of our sister churches in Puerto Rico. It's a place that we have been helping and walking alongside of and getting to partner with for at least 5 years now, as we have sent numerous teams down to Puerto Rico to help and to be a part of what God is doing down there. And your giving makes that possible. And so the session has budgeted resources for short-term mission trips. The session has approved special offerings and fundraisers. And so just know that when you give to this church, part of those resources go to seeing God's work done not only here, but all around the world. And Puerto Rico is just one of those examples. We are grateful for that. Well, let's say thank you to the Lord and ask a prayer of thanksgiving over this offering. Heavenly Father, we are grateful that You are a good God, that You give us so many good gifts, and we thank You for these gifts. And we lift up, Lord, all of the tithes and the offerings that are given this week, gifts of financial resources, gifts of time. Lord, we are grateful that You have given us so much. And we ask, Lord, that You would bless and receive the offering that is collected this week and multiply it, make it more than enough to accomplish all that You desire to see happen in and through Your church, Your dearly beloved church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, my notes, I just looked at my notes, and it says I was supposed to do that prayer after the doxology. So thank you for your forgiveness and bearing with me. But let's stand and give praise and glory to God, our Father. Let's remain standing. I didn't expect that John was going to be over here on the organ today, and what a treat that is for us. But let's continue to worship the Lord as we sing together, "O Come to the Altar."
Yeah.
joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Special for you. I see Jake in the back there getting ready to head for Children's Church. So if you want to join Jake for Children's Church today, you are welcome to make your way out the front door right up here. And look at all these kids getting ready to go hear about Jesus at Children's Church. That is fantastic. Let's pray for our kids as they head downstairs. Heavenly Father, we do pray that you would bless these children and those who instruct them in your ways as they make their way downstairs for Children's Church. Would they each know that they belong to you as sons and daughters of God? And may they believe in Jesus Christ and the truths of your word. And may they be built up in the power of your Holy Spirit. This we pray in the name of Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. It is good to be with you again. We continue in our journey through Genesis. We are now to the very final chapters, which is really all kind of one section here. We're going to divide it up into 3 weeks of sermons yet, but I am very excited to come now to this time in chapter 48. We are all the way to the end of Jacob's life, and we're going to sort of see his actions and his words from his deathbed. Now, it was hearing about Alice Sell and her dying, and then a friend of mine from many years of ministry died over the past month, and another, I did a funeral last week for another friend from a previous church as well, and I've been thinking about the end, and that we're all going to die. As a matter of fact, in the funeral last week, one of the things that he used to say is, none of us is going to make it. Not one of us. We're all going to die. And I hope that we know that and that we are prepared to die in order that we might fully live now with the time that the Lord gives us here. And we might make preparations for passing on the faith and extending blessing to the generations that follow. And that is what we see here in this text. This text comes on the heels of Jacob or Israel demanding that Joseph would make sure that his bones would not be laid to rest in Egypt, but that his body would be returned to the promised land, to the place where his ancestors were buried. And so he has received this assurance from Joseph, and here we are at the beginning of chapter 48. Hear now the word of the Lord. After this, Joseph was told, "Behold, your father is ill." So he took with him his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim, and it was told to Jacob, "Your son Joseph has come to you." Then Israel summoned his strength and sat up in his bed. And Jacob said to Joseph, "God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me and said to me, 'Behold, I will make you fruitful and multiply you, and I will make you a company of peoples and will give this land to your offspring after you for an everlasting possession.' And now your two sons who were born to you in the land of Egypt before I came to you in Egypt are mine. Ephraim and Manasseh shall be mine as Reuben and Simeon are. And the children that you fathered after them shall be yours. They shall be called by the name of their brothers in their inheritance. As for me, when I came from Padan to my sorrow, Rachel died in the land of Canaan on the way. Then there was still some distance to go to Ephrath, and I buried her there on the way to Ephrath," that is, Bethlehem. When Israel saw Joseph's sons, he said, "Who are these?" Joseph said to his father, "They are my sons, whom God has given me here." And he said, "Bring them to me, please, that I may bless them." Now the eyes of Israel were dim with age, so that he could not see. So Joseph brought them near him, and he kissed them and embraced them. And Israel said to Joseph, "I never expected to see your face. And behold, God has let me see your offspring also." Then Joseph removed them from his knees, and he bowed himself with his face to the earth. And Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand toward Israel's left hand, and Manasseh in his left hand toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near him. And Israel stretched out his right hand and laid it on the head of Ephraim, who was the younger, and his left hand on the head of Manasseh, crossing his hands, for Manasseh was the firstborn. And he blessed Joseph and said, "The God before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac walked, the God who has been my shepherd all my life long to this day, the angel who has redeemed me from all evil, bless the boys. And in them let my name be carried on, and the name of my fathers Abraham and Isaac, and let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth." When Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand on the head of Ephraim, it displeased him, and he took his father's hand to move it from Ephraim's head to Manasseh's head. And Joseph said to his father, "Not this way, my father, since this one is the firstborn. Put your right hand on his head." But his father refused and said, "I know, my son, I know. He also shall become a people, and he also shall be great. Nevertheless, his younger brother shall be greater than he, and his offspring shall become a multitude of nations." So he blessed them that day, saying, "By you Israel will pronounce blessings, saying, 'God make you as Ephraim and Manasseh.'" Thus he put Ephraim before Manasseh. Then Israel said to Joseph, "Behold, I am about to die, but God will be with you and will bring you again to the land of your fathers. Moreover, I have given to you, rather than to your brothers, one mountain slope that I took from the hand of the Amorites with my sword and with my bow. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this true story of Jacob, his blessing of Ephraim and Manasseh. Lord, we thank you for Ephraim and Manasseh. We thank you for Joseph and the way that you positioned Joseph at just the right place, at just the right time, in order that you might save many through Joseph. And Lord, we're grateful to see the family of Israel expand we look to our own brothers and sisters here and thank you for allowing us to be a part of your family. Lord, what a joy and a privilege. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I love Genesis. This story of Genesis and the story of Jacob becoming Israel and being on the march. And here on his very deathbed, we see a switcho changeo of sorts. Everything's all mixed up from the way we might expect or the way the world might have expected things. As we said last week, Jacob has demanded that when he died, he is not to be buried in Egyptian soil, but he is to be taken back to the promised land. He wants his descendants not to see their fruitfulness in Egypt as a place where they say, oh, our fruitfulness is found in Egypt. But he wants his descendants after him to know that it is the Lord who makes them fruitful. It is the Lord who multiplies them. It is the Lord who provides for them. It is the Lord who redeems. It is the Lord and no other, no monetary resources, no amount of sheep, no amount of goats, no amount of camels, no amount of cattle. It is the Lord who provides life and blessing and abundance. And Joseph and Jacob does not want his bones to be in a land where apart from his ancestors, Abraham and Isaac, he wants to be back. He wants his bones to be there. He wants people to look to Israel. And he knows the end is coming. In fact, others know that the end is coming as well. Joseph was even told, hey, your father is ill. And this happens even to this day when a family finds out that a loved one is ill, is nearing the end. The family is often called and gathers. And those words at the very end are treasured. Those thoughts, the final words of affirmation, a final blessing, final thoughts. They're treasured. And Joseph knows this, and he not only wants to see his father, but he wants his father to see his sons. He brings Manasseh and Ephraim, his two sons, to Jacob, and Jacob is told, your son has come to you, and so he summoned his strength, it says. He was at the end, but he mustered one last hurrah, and he was going to get up and be strong in front of his son. And he sat up in bed. That was all the strength that he could muster. He had lived a long life, 147 years on the earth. They were difficult years. Traveling here, he had been cheated, and he had cheated, and he had to navigate the world, and yet throughout his life, he had times where he saw the Lord at work, and the Lord had promised him a place, had promised him a land, had promised to make him fruitful and to multiply him, to make him into a whole company of people, to give him this land as an everlasting possession. But he has moved from the land. And God had told him it was okay to go down into Egypt. And here he is now in Egypt, and he's living out his final days. And God had told him, he had promised that Joseph would be the one to close his eyes. And so here he's to the very end. And so he summoned his strength, what little strength he has left. He can't see anymore. But he sits up in bed to see his son. And Jacob then praised God, reminded Joseph of the promises of God. He said to Joseph, God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me. You know, at the end of life, people don't always remember a whole lot of things. Sometimes they don't remember the things that just happened yesterday, and I feel like that's already started for me. Like, I have a hard time remembering what I had for lunch yesterday, and I joke sometimes that I have some timers, not Alzheimer's. I just have some timers, and I can't remember some things. And as I get older, I know that's going to get worse, and all the statistics say it's going to be more difficult to remember things. I might not remember things that happened a week ago, and maybe you're experiencing some of this now. You just don't remember things the way you used to. But then when you hear a song, a hymn, something you used to sing. You remember those really important moments in your life. It's amazing when you sit with folks who aren't concerned about the little things anymore. They want to talk about the things that matter. What little time they have left, they want to talk about what really matters. And what really mattered to Jacob was that he had heard from the Lord. God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me. Now, Luz was also the name of the place that was called Bethel, which means house of God. Jacob names this place the house of God, and here he receives promises and blessings from God Almighty. God had said to him, "Behold, I will make you fruitful and multiply you." God had said to him, "I will make you a company of peoples." God had said to him, "I will give you this land to your offspring after you for an everlasting possession." God had richly blessed him. And these words that we hear here, they're very connected with the same words that God had spoken to Isaac and that God had spoken also to Abraham. We're reminded that these blessings are for this family that God had chosen from amidst all the families of the earth. God had chosen Abraham and chosen to make him his, chosen to be his God, and to make his name great, and to make him into a nation, and a nation that all the nations of the earth would be blessed through. God was working on making a people fruitful and multiplying them, that they would be a large, a numerous people that would bless the whole earth. So what was most important to Jacob at the very end? It was his faith. It was his trust in God Almighty. And here then he says, "And now about your two sons who were born to you in the land of Egypt before I came to you in Egypt, they are now mine." I don't know how many of you are up for an adoption at your age. How many you want to add to the people that you need to add into your will at the end of your life? Maybe some of you have already worked out your inheritance, what you're going to leave the kids. Imagine what your kids might think if you decided to add a couple more right at the very end. But here he is. He says to Joseph, "Your two sons, they are now mine." What is going on here? Israel, he conducts a deathbed adoption. Now, in these times, it was actually a normal thing where a grandfather could say, "Hey, these are now going to be mine." He is wanting not only Joseph, but Joseph's children to be a part of the covenant family. There has been all sorts of strife in this family. Favoritism shown from the very beginning as Jacob gave Joseph that coat of many colors. All the brothers hated him for it. All the brothers wanted him dead, and they basically made him as if he was dead. They sold him into slavery, and yes, he went into slavery, but it was God's plan to save not only Israel, but also the nations. And here is Joseph now, all the second in command, maybe the second strongest person in all of the world. And Jacob is saying, "No, all of my sons are going to be a part of my family, my heritage." And how is he going to have Joseph's family come back to the promised land? Well, here he says, "Your sons, Joseph, are now mine. I adopt them formally." We know that Joseph had 11 other brothers: Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, Asher, Issachar, Zebulun, and Benjamin. All these other brothers, the first four born to Leah, the wife of Jacob that he was tricked into marrying by his uncle Laban. The two that followed, Dan and Naphtali, were born to Bilhah, Rachel's maidservant, and Gad and Asher to Leah's maidservant, Zilpah. And then Leah had a couple more sons, Issachar and Zebulun, and a daughter, Dinah. And then Rachel, finally, the beloved wife of Jacob, finally had a son, Joseph. And Joseph was Jacob's favorite. He treasured him. And he lost his wife Rachel, and so he longed to see Joseph again, and here he's finally laying eyes on him and now his sons. But how is he going to restore and bring this family back together? Well, it's time for the inheritance. Reuben had lost his firstborn right going into his father's bed, and so then the question is, well, who gets the inheritance? Now, if you understand something about the inheritance in these days, the inheritance would be divided among all of the sons, but the firstborn, the eldest, if he lived a life that was pleasing to the father and honoring to the father, would receive a double portion. And so if there were 12 sons, there would have been 13 portions to be given. Two going to the firstborn and one portion to all the remainder. And so there's been this question and there's been this thought as we've gone through, who is going to receive the first right blessing? We remember that Reuben, by going into his father's bed and sleeping with his father's maidservant Bilhah, Rachel's maidservant Bilhah, he ended his chances. He lost his firstborn rights. And Simeon and Levi, you remember in that city Shechem where they tricked the Shechemites into becoming circumcised that they might be able to be in the covenant and be in marriage with the daughters of Israel and the Israelites with the daughters of Shechem, with the Shechemites. And they tricked the men. And then they went and they slaughtered the men and brought great harm to Israel, to his name and to his status in the land. And so they were probably out. Judah, his life was a whole mess. And so you have the favorite son of the favorite wife who now is eligible to receive the firstborn right. Because the two main wives would have been, their children would have been the ones to receive it. But here now, Jacob, he gives the double portion to Joseph. And how does he do it? He does it by claiming Joseph's sons as his own, by adopting them. He adopts Ephraim and Manasseh. It's interesting that in the beginning of this text, it says that Joseph took with him his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim, listing Manasseh first, always the firstborn, always getting the priority. But then when it says that, when Jacob says that, when I came to you, Ephraim and Manasseh, they shall be mine, he switches the names. He puts the youngest in front of the oldest, and he says, they shall be mine as Reuben and Simeon are. They are to be like my own. They're to receive an inheritance. They're to be like brothers with all of your other brothers, Joseph. I don't want them growing up Egyptian, thinking that everything they have is from Egypt, from the gods of Egypt, but I want them to know they are sons of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I want them to have a portion of the inheritance, a double portion, for them to be with God's people. Not to look to Egypt, but to look to the Lord. And so Israel adopts Ephraim and Manasseh, and he does so in the reverse order. He does this switch-o-change-o thing. Ephraim listed first by Israel, even though Manasseh was the firstborn. And this is the way God has seemed to work throughout Genesis. Abel was chosen over Cain, and Isaac was chosen over Ishmael. Jacob was chosen over Esau. Joseph was chosen over Reuben. Ephraim was chosen over Manasseh. And this is going to be the continuing way that the Lord seems to work, choosing the least, choosing the youngest over the oldest. Moses was chosen over Aaron. David is going to be chosen over all the other sons of Jesse. Solomon is going to be chosen over all the other sons of David. It's God who chooses not what the world thinks is to be chosen, but it's God who chooses a people for himself with his own order, which seems to be upside down from the way the world works. And thank goodness, because if it was up to the way the world works, we would not even be considered in the top million of the best people who have ever lived. When God chooses a people, he doesn't look at us in our works. He chooses us based on his sovereign love and grace and mercy and forgiveness. He chooses a people like you and me to be adopted, to be brought into the family, to be made full heirs. And so in this world, let us not look to the Egypt of this world. Let us not look to the stock market, the size of our house, the size of our bank account. Let us look to the Lord who is our provider. Let us look to the Lord who is our redeemer. Let us look to the Lord who has adopted us. There may not be a greater doctrine in the scriptures than the doctrine of adoption. The fact that we did nothing, but God chose us and he makes us his own, just as Jacob here has chosen Manasseh and Ephraim, Ephraim and Manasseh, and chosen them to be his. It's such a grace. It's such mercy. Well, this very adoption is mentioned in the New Testament as well. If you look to Hebrews chapter 11, we see the purpose. The Hebrews chapter 11 is sometimes described as the hall of faith. The hall of fame of the Bible, the hall of faith. And hear what it says. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, who had received the promises, was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom it was said, Through Isaac shall your offspring be named. He considered that God was even able to raise him from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. By faith, Isaac invoked future blessings on Jacob and Esau, and by faith, Jacob, when dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, bowing in worship over the head of his staff. It was a move of faith, trusting that God was going to make his name and all of his descendants great, trusting that God was shaping and forming this people, trusting in faith that God was working in the family of Abraham, Isaac, and now Jacob. And Joseph, and it says in verse 22 of Hebrews 11, by faith Joseph at the end of his life made mention of the Exodus to the Israelites and gave directions concerning his bones. He too didn't want his bones left in Egypt. He wanted to be buried in the promised land, the land that had been promised to his great-grandfather Abraham, the land that had been promised to his grandfather Isaac, the land that had been promised to his father Jacob, and now the land that had been promised to he and his sons after him. He wanted to be an Israelite, to put his lot with the Lord. And then we see in verses 8 and following the ceremony. He's already claimed them. He said, now I'm going to adopt them. They're going to be mine. But now here is the ceremony. I love it. In verse 8, it says, when Israel saw Joseph's son, he said, Who are these? Now we know that he couldn't see very well. And so maybe he was just wondering, well, who's here? I want to make sure I have the right kids. But what I think is actually happening here is that this is a part of the ceremony. When you come and you have seen that I've gotten to do a baptism, we've gotten to celebrate that a child of believing parent is now a part of this covenant community of faith. I always ask, as we have the waters of baptism, I always ask the parents right before doing it, now, what is the name of your child? Now, I know the name. I've been praying for this child. I know the name. I know the family. We've sent out communications to the family. We've celebrated with this family. But I asked the parents, what is the name? It's a way to allow the parents to have this part in this thing. And it's also very practically helpful for me, just in case I've forgotten right before I baptize them, that I baptize them with the right name. And I think that's what's going on here. Joseph is asked, who are these? And Joseph, he doesn't provide the names to his father, because he knows that his father knows the names. But these children are about to become officially a part of Jacob's family. And he says, these are my sons whom God has given to me. Joseph understood that all his blessings, his children, they were gifts of God. Most of the people in the world understood that children were gifts from God. Our world today, we tend not to view children Our society, we don't necessarily view children in the womb as gifts from God. And it's sad in our world today that there is so many seeking to destroy what God has given. God is the one who gives life. God is the one who gives children. And Joseph recognizes that. These are the sons who God has given to me. And Jacob then says, well, bring them to me that I may bless them. And his eyes, he couldn't see very well. And so Joseph, he arranged everything the way it was supposed to be, right? You put the oldest one on the right and the youngest one on his left. And that way, when Jacob went to bless the kids, the oldest would receive the priority blessing. And Jacob is just so enamored, kissing them, embracing them, and just so thankful. Because here he was for 20 years thinking he had lost Joseph forever. And now he not only gets to see Joseph, but the grandchildren as well. The offspring that are to be now his, to be called by his name, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and now Ephraim and Manasseh. So Joseph, he takes the kids from next to Joseph, and he bows himself with his face to the earth. He shows reverence to his father. He too is asking in this action to receive a blessing from Jacob. And Jacob indeed gives Joseph a blessing, it says in verse 15, and it says he stretched out his hands, and we get the sense that Joseph, his eyes were closed, at least at the beginning, because the arms go out and crosses his hands. He does this switcho chango. Yes, he understands that Joseph was going to bring the kids and put Manasseh at Jacob's right, and Jacob was going to put Ephraim at his left. And so he switches his hands and he lays his right hand upon the younger, and he then begins to speak, saying, "The God before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac walked, the God who has been my shepherd all my life long to this day, the angel who has redeemed me from all evil, bless the boys. And in them let my name be carried on, then the name of my fathers Abraham and Isaac, and let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth." These boys receive the blessing. And then Joseph, he was peeking during the blessing. He peeked and opened his eyes. He sees what has happened. And in the English here, it says that it displeased him, but that's not strong enough. He was angry. He was furious. He could understand. He's, "No, you've ruined the blessing. The blessing was supposed to go to Manasseh, but the blessing has been done. The blessing has been made." And he tries to switch Jacob's hands in the midst of the blessing. He tries to get him to put his hand where it's supposed to be according to the way things worked. But Jacob, he says, "No, I know my son. I know what's going on." He lived his whole life. He had seen God at work. He had seen the grace and mercy of God. He had seen that God doesn't always choose the way the world chooses. God doesn't select by the way the world operates. God has his own plans, often choosing the younger, often choosing the least, often choosing the one who you wouldn't expect to do his amazing work. But God hasn't forgotten Manasseh. God will also bless this one. And so he reminds Joseph that this one too shall be a great nation. And he blessed them that day, saying, "God make you as Ephraim and Manasseh." Israel is going to pronounce blessings on the world, on all the nations, by saying, "May God make you like Ephraim and Manasseh." Children who have grown up with privilege, but do not consider that as their source, are gonna come to the land that it was promised to them by God. They're going to take hold of what the Lord has provided, and they are going to become great. And so the blessing that is to go forth from this day on is to be a blessing in the name of Ephraim and Manasseh. And then he reminds Jacob, "I'm going to die. None of us makes it. But God will be with you. God will bring you again to the land of your fathers. God, who was the God of my father Abraham and Isaac, they walked before him. And God, who has been my shepherd. Some language here that David then grasps a hold of in perhaps one of your favorite psalms, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. And Jacob understood God is his shepherd. The Lord is his shepherd. There's sort of this triune formula in this blessing. The God of his fathers. The God who is the shepherd. This angel who has given redemption. And so then the question to us is the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, is this God your God? Is the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob the God of Manasseh and Ephraim? Is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Joseph, and Ephraim, and Manasseh, is he your God? He watches over you. He protects you. He is a good shepherd. And even if you stray and leave the rest of the flock, he'll leave the 99 to go and search for you because he loves you. He's chosen you. He has adopted you as his son. And as his daughter, and he will not lose you because you are his. Do you know this love? A love that was willing to go to the greatest depths, to pay the greatest price, to ensure that you are his. That's what we celebrate at this table. We celebrate the death of Jesus that we might have an inheritance with Christ. We might be known as his. We didn't deserve it, but we were adopted and we were given an inheritance, and we talked about that inheritance in our call to worship today. It was set aside from before the foundation of the earth. Before we had even done a single thing, it's not about our works and our actions that gets us into heaven. We can't spend enough money to buy adoption. It has to be by God's choice, his sovereign plan. Well, I hope you have the Lord as your shepherd. Because if you do, you shall not want. Maybe in this world you may want, but there will be a day to come when you will not want, when all of their weeping will be turned into joy. You'll be dancing on streets paved in gold because your Father, your heavenly Father, has called you his son, and so you dance in his city. God will be with you, Joseph. God will bring you again to the land of your fathers. Don't forget your heritage. And I'm going to give you a piece of the promised land. I've given to you, rather than to your brothers, one mountain slope. It's literally Shechem, that very place that his sons Simeon and Levi slaughtered those people. He says here, I took this from the hand of the Amorites with my sword and with my bow. And now it's yours. I'm giving you this land, Shechem, this place where Abraham came and worshiped the Lord his God. I'm giving you this place. I'm giving you a place. And wouldn't you know it, as we look all the way into Joshua and the story of the people coming in and claiming the promised land, where is Joseph laid to rest? Where are his bones placed? None other than Shechem, the very place that was given to him. It is time to have faith in this God. We've been walking through seeing the promises of this God come true and come true and come true and come true. His promises never fail, and his promises will never fail. He has promised to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to Joseph, to Ephraim, to Manasseh, and even to you and me that he will make his people great. He has a land, a family, a home, and you too can be a part of this covenant family. Not by anything you do, not by the amount of money you have in your bank account, but because he has chosen you. And he wants you to be in his family and to receive a portion of the inheritance. You're his favorite. And I hope you know that. And I also hope you know that there are others in this world, outside of these walls, that the Lord has chosen. God says that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. There are others of our brothers and sisters that are out there. And God wants to bring them in and bring them a part of the family. So keep your eyes open. Because you, when you go to work, you might be sitting across from your brother or sister. And maybe they don't even know it yet. And God is working on bringing them in full adoption at just the right time. People in your family who maybe have been far from the Lord for a long time, perhaps the Lord is waiting to bring them in, to adopt them as well, and maybe you'll get to be there on the day that they are adopted, rejoicing that you have another brother, that you have another sister, rejoicing that God has expanded the family. Keep your eyes open and be in prayer. Be in prayer. I believe God wants to expand his family. He wants to see his family grow. We get so excited every time we see our church family grow. The Smiths just had a baby, and we get all excited because there's another one of us. It's not just Chelsea's daughter, Brinley. It's our daughter. And we celebrate, and we rejoice. So keep your eyes open. Pray. Ask the Lord, who is the Lord inviting to become part of our family? And maybe you will be there on that adoption day. What a glorious day that will be. And I pray that one day we will declare God has blessed us like Ephraim and Manasseh. Richly blessed us with a double portion of the inheritance. Thanks be to God. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you have chosen to adopt your people, to engraft those of us who did not have a birthright, to become part of your family. Lord, you bring us not in as second-class citizens, but you give us full citizenship in your kingdom. You give us full standing because of the work of your Son, Jesus. Lord, we are so grateful this day to celebrate your goodness, to do this great switcho changeo with us, where the sin of our lives is imparted and imputed onto Christ, and his death on the cross and the blood that he shed is given for us, and we, in return for our sins on him, we are given the righteousness of Christ and made full heirs in your kingdom. Lord, what a privilege it is to come this day and worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, let us stand and confess our faith together, confessing the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of God the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Would you please be seated? We're going to be coming shortly to the table in just a few moments. One of our sisters has agreed to share her gift of singing with us. Janine Lochran is going to share her gift of singing. Linda Steele is going to be sharing her gift. Our sister Linda is going to be playing the piano. They've prepared this time as we begin to prepare to come to the table. And so I want us to think about what this table means, how we have been purchased by God. You know, adoption in this world can be very expensive. Those who are seeking to adopt, they know it can be very expensive, but God was willing to pay the ultimate price that we would be His. And so let us meditate on His goodness, on His forgiveness, on His grace as we prepare to come to the Lord's table. Pretty good day of worship. We got John and the praise team with doing a wonderful job. John even playing the organ for us. Janine sharing her voice with us. The Word of God proclaimed. God choosing to send His Son Jesus for us. And now we get to taste and see that the Lord is good and experience His goodness afresh and anew. We are about to come to the Lord's table and worship. This isn't my table. This isn't Bethany Church's table. This is the Lord's table. And all who believe in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior and have been baptized unto His name are invited to come and partake as children of God, to taste His forgiveness, to be strengthened in His body. I don't care if you have a Catholic background, or a Methodist background, or a Baptist background, or yes, even if you've been a lifelong Presbyterian, you do not have to be a Presbyterian to come to this table. You need to believe in Jesus and be baptized into His name. If you did not already pick up one of these communion cups, would you just let us know, and our usher will be happy to bring you one of these. But let us now give thanks to the Lord for this meal. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this time of feasting. Lord, this feast that we have before us is a foreshadow of the feast that is to come, and we thank you for this bread and this fruit of the vine. We ask that you would set it apart from its ordinary use to the extraordinary meal that you have provided for us. Lord, you are, in fact, our provider. We didn't purchase this meal, but you have given it to us. Lord, we thank you. We ask that you would be blessed in this time. Lord, we ask that we would be reminded of our sins and we would confess to you our sinfulness. And Lord, that we would be reminded of the forgiveness that we do have in Jesus. Lord, as we taste and touch, may we feel your presence with us here today. And may you be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, we'll remember that on the night our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same manner, after the supper, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink, all of you, in remembrance of me." And as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. And he's coming again because he promised he was coming again, and he always makes good on his promises. That's the story of Genesis over and over and over again. And we here today are a little glimpse of the promises coming to fulfillment. And as we taste and feast on our Lord, may we be reminded that we are his and that he gave his very life that we would be certain we are his. And so let us take and eat. If you would now take the portion of the little cup, take the clear plastic off of the top. This is the body of Christ given for you and for me. Take and eat. And if you'll now remove the foil, and if you spill, it's okay because our seats are all this color. Let us remember the cost that we would be called sons and daughters of God. Brothers and sisters, this is the blood of Christ shed for you and for me. Take and drink. And let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much again for this holy meal. Lord, we bless your name, and we ask, Lord, that your name would be lifted high among all the names in the earth, in the world, in the universe. Lord, your name is to be lifted high. You are the one true God. You are the God who promised to take a people upon yourself, to adopt others and bring them into the family like I have been adopted in, Lord, and we celebrate that we are family. And we rejoice with our brothers and sisters this day in your goodness to us. Lord, we praise you, we thank you, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, we have hope to come. This meal is a foretaste of that which is to come. We have the living hope, Christ. Let us stand and worship our living hope as we sing together, Living Hope.
Shadows of my soul, the work
Blessing over them, and I put my hand on their head and I say, may the Lord bless you and keep you, may the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you, may the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. I say that just about every night to my kids. Last night I changed it up and I went with the blessing here in Genesis 48. The blessing, he said, by you, Israel, pronounce blessing, saying, God make you as Ephraim and as Manasseh. And that's what I did last night. And it was wonderful. I don't know if you've already been in the habit of blessing your children, but if you have children or grandchildren at home with you, I want to encourage you at night to lay your hand on their head. The laying on of hands is a wonderful thing. And to ask God to bless them. And maybe, just maybe, you might use and incorporate this blessing into, you have your grandkids come and visit, bless them, richly bless them. And we'll ask the Lord to do what he's already promised to do. And so what a joy it is. And so I want you now to receive a blessing from our Lord. And so if you would like to receive that blessing, just put your arms out in a posture of receiving and know that these are words from the Lord to you. May you be as Ephraim and as Manasseh, to the praise and glory of God Almighty. Amen and amen.